Good evening, and welcome to Weird-O-Rama. I'm your host, Victor von Psychotron, and all of us at Weird-O-Rama will always strive to bring you the creepy.
You're an exciting woman, Pearl.
The strange.
25 hamburgers, 20 lamb chops, or 2 whole chickens.
And of course, the weird. Tonight we bring you our second Christmas Weird-tacular, where we give you a... Tonight is our second Christmas Weird-tacular, which brings you a sort of Chex Mix, if you will, of Yuletide oddities from television and ephemeral cinema. Tonight we have 2 classic TV comedies for you, featuring those wacky Clampetts and... Ozzy. Not the gentleman from Black Sabbath, unfortunately. Ozzy and Harriet, however. And we also have a short film on the joys of shopping, and we'll have some classic television toy commercials for you and other little delights here and there. So, put on your Christmas cap, hang your stockings with care, have a cup of eggnog, and enjoy our latest Christmas Weird-tacular.
You're headed for Dead Man's Gulch.
Oh, no. I'm taking my trusty steed over this fence.
Those Indians shut your horse right out from under you. Go back 2 squares.
It looks like the poison water hole for you, partner. It's my turn again.
Wow, you can jump the fence with a shortcut. The Remco's Cowboys and Indian game, hours of fun spin barn. Get one or all of these Remco giant wheel games. Thrills and Spills horse race, Cowboys and Indians, or Picture Bingo. Only $3.98 each at your favorite toy store. Remember, every boy wants a Remco toy.
And so do girls.
How long do you reckon it'll take us to get home, Paul?
Get through a figure, it's about 6 days, hard driving. Where are you going with that wood?
Well, Granny wants it on the truck.
Put it down. With all the wood we got back at the cabin, we sure ain't going to haul none from Beverly Hills.
Oh, she says it's for on the way.
On the way? Granny, what in the world are you doing?
I'm making sure we don't freeze to death.
It's warm here.
Won't be when we get in the mountains.
You figure to keep that thing burning for us 6 days?
And 6 nights. Don't forget. It's December every other place but here. Damn, blame California. The weather's as mixed up as the people. I'll be glad when I get back where there's some snow and ice.
I can't wait to see Ma and Jeff Green.
Yeah, it'll be my fine Christmas present for your Ma and your sister, us dropping in on them like this.
Now tell me again, exactly what did Marie say?
She simply said the Clampetts were loading their truck and appeared to be moving out.
Why? What could have happened? Who offended them? Whoever it was, I'll have them driven out of Beverly Hills.
Chief, don't get so upset. I know a man with $25 million in your bank is...
Is that why you think I'm upset? Because Jed Clampett has $25 million in my bank?
Isn't it?
Of course not. The thing that upsets me is the fact he might take it out.
I don't know whatever happened to the key to that door, but I reckon with our stuff out of there, ain't nothing left anybody want to take, except some old pictures.
Oh, Miss Hathaway says a couple of them pictures is Rembrandt.
All right, after Christmas, we'll see he gets them back.
Stop!
Stop! Where are you going?
Going home.
What?
Please, you can't go away and leave me like this.
All right, climb on. I reckon we got room for you.
Oh, my heavens, we caught you before you left.
Granny, is there room for two back there?
Yeah, if you want to squat next to the stove.
No, we don't want to go with you. We want you to stay here.
We'll be back after Christmas.
Well, Mr. Clampett, if you want to go home for Christmas, let me make the arrangements. I'll have you there tonight.
Tonight?
Clean back home?
Yes, and you'll arrive in style, too. Well, Miss Hathaway, I think Granny and Ellie Mae should have mink coats for the trip, don't you?
Of course.
Well, let's go take care of it, and the reservations, too. Mr. Clampett, you start unloading the truck and leave everything to us. You'll be home in 5 or 6 hours on a jet.
What's a jet, Paul?
I don't know, bus or jitney, I reckon.
Get us here tonight?
You heard what he said. Well, that will be a surprise to Pearl.
Uncle Jed, it took us 6 days to get out of here. How are we going to get back home in 5 or 6 hours?
That bus driver must know a doozy of a shortcut.
Plenty of champagne and caviar?
I guess so. Why?
The entire first-class section has been reserved for a family of VIPs, the Clampetts.
Wow.
Young ladies, I presume you've been advised of special arrangements for the Clampett family?
Oh, yes, indeed.
Certainly have. Here they come now. Oh, get a load of those minks. Yeah. Granny, Ellie Mae, right this way. I'm sure you'll be quite comfortable in the lounge. Wait.
Uh-oh. How did they get past the gate?
Let's get them out of here before the Clampetts see them. I'm afraid you're in the wrong section. May I see your tickets, please?
Well, I don't think we got any. See, this bus sure is fancy.
Why? You've come to the wrong place. You want the bus station.
Now, just go back the way you came and ask for the traveler's aid. Now, they'll help you.
Oh, yeah. Well, thank you, ma'am. Granny, Ellie Mae, come on. We're on the wrong bus.
Mr. Clampett, what's the trouble?
This is Mr. Clampett?
Of course. Right this way. Jethro? Here, Jethro. Keep the tickets. Now, Mr. Clampett, you have the money Mr. Drysdale gave you.
Yes, ma'am. Right here.
A limousine will meet you and take you to Pearl's house. And Mr. Drysdale is phoning ahead to Mr. Brewster to be sure your cabin is in order.
Well, don't let him give away a surprise to Pearl.
Oh, he won't. Well, happy landing, Merry Christmas, and au revoir.
Merry Christmas to you, too.
And Jethro, here's something for you if you promise to bring it back to me. Take good care of them, and remember, the tall, young, good-looking one is mine.
May I have your coat?
My coat, please.
Well, it's brand spanking new.
Oh, I'll take good care of it.
Well, it's Christmas. I got my rheumatiz medicine to keep me warm. You can have it.
Can I have your coat, please?
Should I, Paul?
Well, I reckon not. We don't mind sharing with folks, but when they get grabby and wanting everything, well, we just got to mule up and say no. If you can't afford to buy a coat of your own, here, you just peel off whatever you need.
No, Mr. Clampett, you misunderstood. We just want to hang the coats up. We don't want you to give them to us.
Oh, well, that's very neighborly of you. Thank you very much.
Now, if you'll all be seated over here until we get underway.
Come on, go.
Now, fasten your belt.
Well, I ain't wearing one, ma'am. Just my galluses.
I meant your seat belt.
Doggies. This is a fancy bus. Looks like the bus is commencing to pull out.
Now we'll see if this bus driver knows an all-fire fancy shortcut.
Ellie, that's you and me watch the road so we can remember it.
Okay, Jethro.
Jethro,
Beats me, this bus driver of ours is lost. Just keeps us circling and a turning.
No, there's no shortcut yet.
Ding, ding.
Listen to him erasing that engine.
Yeah, but the wheels must be spinning in the mud. We ain't moving.
He got her out of the mud.
Yeah, we're moving now. Lickety split, too.
My dog is, if he gets to going much faster, this thing is going to leave the ground.
Don't look now, but it is leaving the ground.
Jethro, you better get up there and tell that bus driver to slow down.
He ain't got time for that. Let's get off of this thing before it gets any higher.
Now, wasn't that a smooth takeoff?
You may unfasten your seatbelts anytime you like. Would you folks like some champagne and caviar? Or would you prefer a nice hot meal?
We have steak, chicken, fish, anything you like.
Oh, no thanks. We had a mess of grits and jowls before we left home.
Perhaps you'd like to relax then. Take a little nap.
There.
Whoop. Doggies. Granny, ain't that something?
It's good for the rheumatiz.
Now, if there's anything else that we can do to make your trip more comfortable, just press the little button.
And we'll be right here.
Them girls ain't a bit scared.
Sure is friendly, too. Offering to share their food with them. Makes me feel ashamed we didn't let them keep our coat.
You want me to go up and talk to the bus driver, Uncle Jed?
I reckon not, Jethro. Don't nobody else seem skittish, and we don't want folks to think this is our first bus ride.
Marshall! He just dug up the bank! He's headed for Deadwood!
You'll never get away with this, Slippery Sam!
Marshal Bob is riding Blaze, the fabulous new galloping horse from Mattel. See, his legs actually move just like a real horse. There's no other riding horse anywhere that gallops like Blaze. Now watch this. When you bounce on Blaze, he romps along like a frisky colt. He gallops when you rock back and forth on him, but he's so safe, you just can't tip over. Blaze is the safest, strongest horse made.
Okay, Flippery. This is the end of the line.
Almost got away, Marshal, if it weren't for that lightning-fast horse of yours. Where'd you get him?
You can get Mattel's Blaze wherever toys are sold.
And just wait till Dad sees how easy it is to set up. Just pop him out of the box, spread the stand, and tighten just one bolt. That's all there is to it. And see how safe and solidly built Blaze is. You can tell it's Mattel. It's swell.
Jed.
Yeah, Granny?
It sure will be nice to see snow again, won't it?
That's the truth. Christmas just don't seem like Christmas without it.
And Pearl's house is all especial pretty in the snow.
She sure is going to be surprised when we all come tromping in there tonight.
Howdy, Pearl.
Homer Winch, when are you going to learn not to walk into a body's house without a body inviting you?
Well, I rang and you didn't come.
You didn't give me time, you old coot. Now, don't you never do that again. Get out of my parlor.
I like you when you're mad, Pearl. You're an exciting woman.
Homer, you get out of here. I don't have time for your foolishness. Jethreen and me is going to California to spend Christmas with Cousin James.
Well, and I reckon you don't care to hear what I got to say.
That's right.
About Mr. Brewster.
Mr. Brewster?
Yeah, that tall, good-looking city fella works for the oil company, drives that big car.
What about him? Is he in town?
I've been ordered from your parlor, Pearl. I think I'd best be going.
Homer, I didn't mean it. Please, Homer, you tell me about Mr. Brewster, and I'll bake you a sweet potato pie.
Well?
And for dessert, red horse swimming in elderberry wine.
You're an exciting woman, Pearl.
Tell me.
Well, you see, he stopped over at the Emporium to get some cheese and crackers. Said he was going to be over at Jed's cabin alone all day, and he didn't have no food.
Thank you, Homer. Merry Christmas.
Now, wait a minute, Pearl. You ain't going to do me out of my tater pie, are you?
Well, of course not. You get it.
Well, when?
Well, I'll let you know. I'm busy right now. Bye, Homer.
Ding, dang, darn it. I done it again. Let some pretty woman twist me around her finger. I hate to go home. Mama's going to give me the dickens.
Jed.
Hey, Granny.
I just had a terrible thought.
What's that?
Suppose we get to Pearl's house and she ain't there.
Where would she be?
Out chasing that rooster fella, that's where.
Ah, she ain't likely to catch him in her horse and buggy.
Whoa, Betsy. Now, Betsy, I play my cards right. You get to keep that there blanket permanent. Because I'm going to have something else to keep me warm. A husband. Ain't that a beautiful word, husband? Husband. And what's more, I'll be riding in that big, fancy automobile. So you can retire to pasture with that good-looking race horse from Hot Springs.
Well, I thought I heard a horse. Mrs. Modine. Won't you come in?
Well, thank you. It's a mighty cold today, ain't it?
It is. Well, it's nice to see you again. I'm sorry it's so cold in here. Didn't bother to build a fire in the fireplace, and I'm afraid that kerosene stove doesn't put out much heat.
Well, I can't stay but a minute. I just came by to give you this and say Merry Christmas.
Well, thank you. Oh, you shouldn't have.
Oh, it's just something that I made myself.
Oh, nice.
Land to mercy. Look at this place. Why, you men just can't manage alone, can you? It takes a woman.
Oh, please don't bother. I won't be here. You see, I'm going home to Tulsa for the holidays.
I won't go to no trouble. I'll just throw together a little snack, and while you're eating, I'll tidy up a bit.
Is the most fantastic miracle I've ever seen. The way you produced this banquet right out of thin air. Ham, fried chicken, roast pork, and this delicious sweet potato pie.
That's Mom's special recipe. Oh. Here, wash it down with some red horse and elderberry juice.
Oh, that is sensational juice. But, Mrs. Bodine, I just can't eat another bite. Why, Mrs. Bodine, what have you done to this cabin?
Oh, do you see a difference?
And where did you get those curtains?
Well, I just run them up while you was eating.
Really, you are a remarkable woman. You cook, you sew, you're a wonderful housekeeper.
And I love it. It ain't work to me at all. It's pure enjoyment.
Mrs. Bodine, I know that this must seem awfully sudden to you, and I know you have lots of ties and lots of activities here in the hills, but I was wondering, do you think you could possibly be happy living in a city like Tulsa?
Tulsa? That's where you live, ain't it?
Yes, I have a very nice home there, but frankly, it needs you, and I think Mother will agree.
You want me to meet your mother?
Well, actually, it isn't necessary, and I know Mother will approve my choice. Now, you don't have to give me your answer immediately. You just think it over and...
Yes, that's my answer. Yes.
But we haven't even discussed money.
I'll give you every cent I make.
Mrs. Bodine, as my housekeeper, I will be paying you.
Housekeeper.
That's Carrie for Mother. Oh, incidentally, Mother's just going to love this elderberry juice. What's the matter? Did you do something?
You sure did. You let me cook for you. You let me sew for you. Hand me the ham. You let me house clean for you. Now then, I don't know what it takes to get engaged in Tulsa, but in these here hills, you've done enough to get yourself promised, hitched, and honeymooned.
Really, Mrs. Bodine, I didn't mean to.
I'm going to Beverly Hills to spend Christmas with my cousin Jeff. And when I tell him what you done, he ain't gonna take kindly to it.
What, Mrs. Bodine? I give you my word that
you give me my hand-knit socks. Your feet can't get no colder than they are right now.
Still tied score. And here's the tie-breaking question for Fenella with her magic Etch-A-Sketch and her opponent Maximilian with his magnetic magnesticks. Ready? Draw or build the biggest animal in the jungle. It's the elephant. They're both right. How do they do it? Etch-A-Sketch draws and writes like magic. Turn the knobs and the lines go up and down and all around. No crayons, no chalks, never any mess. Turn Etch-A-Sketch upside down and shake and everything disappears. Magnesticks builds things magnetically. No nails, no screws, no messy glue. You get over 100 pieces to make trains, planes, animals, dolls, and pretty designs. Develop artistic and scientific skills with Etch-A-Sketch and Magnesticks. They're kid-tested toys from the Ohio Art Company. Hi-o!
They're sleeping like babies.
Do you think we should wake them for the movie?
I don't know. It's a lady super western, just the kind of picture they'd enjoy.
Well, why don't we start it, and if they wake up, fine.
Good idea.
Through that front window. We're chasing some fellas.
They shooting at us.
Exciting, isn't it?
Get down! You was right in the line of fire.
What's going on?
Whatever it is, I'm getting in on it.
But Mr. Drysdale, Pearl is on her way to California to see them.
Can you catch her in time?
Oh, I think so. She's driving a horse and buggy. I'll tell her her family's on the way.
No, this is a surprise.
Well, then what'll I say?
But say anything to keep her there until the Clampetts arrive. Now get over to Pearl's.
Oh, she might misconstrue. You see, I have a very delicate situation here.
Yes, you certainly have.
And if you spoil Jed Clampett's Christmas surprise, he'll cut off your oil.
But Pearl might think I want to marry.
Merry Christmas to you, too.
Hello? Hello? Oh, boy.
Here's the sweet potato pie and red horse, I promise.
Hey, there's a piece of this pie missing. And a gopher two of these red horse. Who got it, Pearl?
None of your business.
Now get along. Jeff Green and me is leaving for California.
Yeah, I want a whole pie just like I was promised.
You get out of here before I throw you out of here. Men is all alike. Gimme, gimme, gimme.
You're an exciting woman, Pearl.
Don't you even speak to me. There ain't a man alive worth the powder it'd take to blow him to you nowhere. Men is just a bunch of low-down, no-good Mr. Brewster.
Bodine, I hope you're not angry at me any longer.
Angry at you? Why, don't be ridiculous. Oh, here, have some more sweet potato pie and some red hoss.
Oh, this is a rascal been trying to steal my woman and my pie. I'm going to give you such a shoo. Oh, I think I throwed my dang knee out.
And I'm going to throw out the rest of you.
You see, in my business, what I mean to say is that I'm away from home a lot. And, I think that a husband should, what I mean to say is that in my opinion, could I have another slug of that elderberry juice?
No, you cannot. Now then. I've been sitting here for 3 solid hours listening to you, and you have yet to say one word that a widow woman could get her teeth into. Jeff Green, bring the suitcases.
Oh, please don't go.
I ain't listening to one more word you've got to say unless you say it on your knees. Don't come in yet, Jeff Green.
Please don't go.
You are the slipperiest man that ever lived. Come on, Jeff Green. You get out of my parlor and you stay out.
You want me to throw him out, Ma?
He can walk. Homer Winch, is that you again?
No, Pearl, it's us. Merry Christmas, Jeff Green.
Uncle Dad!
Why, you have Mr. Brewster, what are you doing?
Mr. Clampett, if you'd been just 1 second later, I'd have been engaged to your cousin Pearl.
Pull back out, everybody! Please, Mr. Clampett!
Jingle bell, jingle bell, jingle all the way.
I'll what fun it is to ride in one horse open sleigh. Dashing through the snow.
You're nothing but a two-timer, Homer Winch. Pearl told me about you sparking her, you old rascal, you.
You're exciting when you're mad, Granny. Hey, how about going for a little sleigh ride with me?
You promise to behave?
Sure I do.
Well, we might as well stay here and sing.
Wish you a Merry Christmas. We wish you a Merry Christmas. We wish you a Merry Christmas. And a Happy New Year.
Hello there. You know, I've been all around this wonderful world of ours, and in all of this world, nothing else is silly putty. What is silly putty? Well, it's a real solid liquid. If you pull it so, it'll go forever, like taffy. But if you give it a sharp tug, it'll break like a biscuit. Now, when you make silly putty round and drop it, it'll bounce higher than a rubber ball. And here's something else you can do with silly putty. Flatten it, press a picture in your newspaper, lift it, stretch it this way and that, and you'll get something that's really funny. Always put your silly putty back in its egg, or it will run slowly away. You can buy Silly Putty for $1 wherever toys are sold. And remember, nothing else is Silly Putty.
Over the town, Father Winter has spread a thick white blanket of snow. This big snowplow is hard at work. But this boy is getting ready to play in the snow. Wraps and mittens and caps keep children warm and dry. Bill Clark pulls a loose-fitting sweater over his woolen shirt. This will keep his body warm without bundling him up too much. Bill's sister Nell and his brother Charlie put closely woven jacket sweaters. They don't intend to let Jack Frost catch them. Nell's overshoes and the boys' ski boots will keep their feet warm and dry.
Come on, let's go! Look out! Oh, Nell!
Here, Charlie.
They're going to make a snowman, and everybody must help. Bill starts the ball for the bottom, Nell the ball for the middle. A little snowball like this grows into a big snowman. The farther it rolls, the larger it grows. The snowman will stand where the largest snowball stops. How big the ball for the body has grown. Teamwork helps to make a good snowman.
Oh, look out!
Charlie, come and help us.
Coming. There it is.
Now, the snowman needs a head, and Charlie has it.
A head for the snowman.
That's right, Bill. Make his neck strong so the head won't fall off. What are Charlie and Nell looking for? And what's Charlie going to do with that shiny tin can?
Look, Charlie, Bill's made his nose. Oh, what a nose. I've got his button. Here's his hat.
Bill has given the snowman a name. His name is Wellington. And what a fine snowman he is.
How do you do, Mr. Wellington?
Another day, another fine blanket of snow. Listen to the children. They're getting ready to play fox and geese. Fox and geese. To play that, you first tramp down a big ring. And then you cut the ring as you'd cut a pie. Tramp down the trails. You cut the pie into two pieces less than the number of children playing.
All fine, Clint. Come on.
The children on the outer ring are geese. Get on your nests where the lines meet the ring. Now you are safe from the boy in the center. He is the fox, and he is it. The extra child is a goose without a nest. And the fox always tries to catch a goose off its nest.
Look out, Shorty.
You're it.
The geese try to change places often. They can only run on the beaten trails. The fox tags Sally, and Sally's it. It's more fun if no one is the fox too long. And no one will be if everyone in the game keeps moving. This is a good day for coasting. Crisp and clear and cold.
Come on.
The hill has been marked with flags. You coast down one side and go back up on the other side of the flags. Charlie wants to slide first. He waits until the coast is clear before he starts down, so he won't run into anyone. He doesn't want to have an accident. Now Bill's going down. And a girl. But where's Nell? What are you going to do with that dishpan, Nell? That's a different kind of a sled. And here's another. And another. Now, everybody, up the hill again. At the top of the hill, Charlie and Bill decide to coast together. They know the best way for two to ride. And now they're off. Down they slide. And so does Nell. And when Charlie and Bill and Nell begin to feel cold, they know it's time to start for home. Skiing today? That's right, Bill. Be sure your bindings are firmly fastened. And you might help Charlie, too. We don't want any loose skis to spoil the fun. Now Charlie's ready, and so is Noel. Now let's see you walk. Remember to keep your skis straight. Then you won't fall. Here's a little hill. The herringbone step keeps you from sliding backward as you climb a little hill. And now, down comes Bill. And down comes Nell. And Charlie comes down. Up again, that's the boy. What's this? A steeper hill. Sidestepping is the best way to climb a steep hill on skis. Bill goes over the top, and down the other side he goes. And then, down goes Nell. And Charlie goes down. Now Bill tries the snowplow. Can Charlie do that too? Nice work, Charlie.
Let's go over to the school slide. Oh, look! Oh, boy!
Ski jumping is great fun. Beginners make little jumps. With more practice, boys and girls learn to make long, graceful leaps, flying through the air like birds. Skiing is perhaps the most thrilling way to enjoy the clear, cold days of winter when the earth is buried under its glistening blanket of snow.
It's refreshment time, folks.
Taste that beats the others cold. Pepsi pours it on. Taste that beats the others cold. Pepsi pours it on.
Yum, yum. It's a meal in itself. Our all-meat super dog. Enjoy one now.
Men, there's a drive-in movie full of juicy people. Wow!
It's a trap! Help! It's Pick! We've had it, men.
A pleasant aroma for you, but not for mosquitoes. Pick is easy to use. Light it and forget it. Pick's aroma keeps mosquitoes, gnats, and sandflies away. Pick is the best protection for barbecues, fishing and camping trips, or just relaxing in the yard.
So if you don't want our company ever anywhere, just like Pick and see what I mean? Bye!
Pick is on sale at the refreshment stand now.
Yes, this is Hillsdale, popularly known as the heart of the San Francisco Peninsula. It is composed of some of the nation's great department stores, many of the leading national chain stores, and important local merchandising names. The 50-acre center is bounded on the south by a large, bustling Sears Roebuck store, on the north by the unique Farmer's Market. The Central Mall is flanked by a well-balanced selection of retail stores in every field and price bracket, which provides all customers with the most complete comparative shopping in the entire area. And there is plenty of free parking, over 5,000 individual parking spaces. Six fine stores in all at the present time, which will expand to approximately 100.
¶¶
major department store in the center is the magnificent three-story Macy operation. One of the gayest attractions at Hillsdale is the fabulous Farmer's Market, which draws throngs of people day and night for dining and food shopping. The outstanding feature of the Farmer's Market is the fact that each of the 22 departments is run by a specialist in his particular field. The colorful dining patio is surrounded by a most unique and diversified collection of convenient stands, offering a complete selection of American and foreign foods. There is everything from a mouth-watering smokehouse and typical American barbecue stand to Chinese and Spanish foods, along with all the popular Italian dishes. The other departments in this huge market flank the central aisle and offer every type and description of food from all over the world. Each type of food is handled by a separate concessionaire who is a specialist in buying and preparing these edibles to suit the most particular gourmet. The personal service of the Farmer's Market Meat Department is one of its greatest attractions, with extensive cutting rooms and a staff of expert butchers to serve the finest of meats. The expansive produce department offers a choice selection of the freshest grown fruits and vegetables available. Of course, the mainstay of any food operation is the grocery department. And the Farmer's Market boasts one of the most modern and complete departments of this kind in the area. All in all, Hillsdale's unique Farmer's Market is the most diversified food market in Northern California. And now let's see just how shopping can be fun, real fun, at this modern and convenient shopping center. Hillsdale's first spring season featured a colorful blossom festival, a blending of high fashion and beautiful flowers. The mall was elaborately decorated in fresh-cut blossoms, and the landscaped area was in full bloom with seasonal flowers. The exciting Easter season featured many special activities that were planned to entertain the youngsters and to give Mother a little more freedom for her shopping. Giant Easter basket on the mall was the temporary home of Mr. and Mrs. Easter Bunny, who hosted many television stars to the delight of crowds of happy children. Hillsdale's first annual automobile show was launched with a horseless carriage caravan, intermingling the cars of yesteryear with a full showing of 1956 models. These cars paraded the entire peninsula area and returned to be on display for 10 days on the mall. In conjunction with the latest in automobile design and color, all of the center's retailing clothing stores joined forces to put on Hillsdale's first spring fashion show, featuring the latest attire for the entire family. Moana, popular television star of the Harry Owen Show, was the queen of our Armed Forces Day celebration. On behalf of Hillsdale, Moana visited Army, Navy, and other military installations for several days. The climax of this event was her appearance at Hillsdale, dancing for an amateur photographer's contest, which was held in conjunction with the opening of a new photo shop on the mall. The spectacular 16-day travel and vacation show, providing fun for everyone. The mall was literally covered with cabin cruisers, outboards, station wagons, house trailers, camping equipment of all types. Even an airplane. The enthusiastic public response and attendance at this show assured its continued success as an annual event. It also provided an excellent opportunity for the retailers to merchandise to the coming vacation season. One of the highlights of the show was the fishing pond, where young and old alike tried their hand at catching big, beautiful rainbow trout. An archery contest was just one of the many special events during the travel show. Trophies and prizes were awarded not only to the archers, but to judo wrestlers, international folk dancers, and many others. Ringling and the other big tops folded in 1956, but Hillsdale brought the circus back to life with a big midsummer carnival. Thousands of eager children mobbed the Hillsdale big top on the mall to enjoy the antics of the clowns and the tricks of the animals. The shows were rounded out with watermelon and pie-eating contests, prizes, balloons, and all the typical carnival activities. The gay circus theme was carried into illuminated carousel decorations, and all stores enthusiastically tied in with a carnival spirit. Dad's a Doll was our theme, and the children of the Hillsdale area performed a complete operetta as a salute to Dad on his day. Beniamino Bufano, one of the world's greatest contemporary sculptors, was commissioned to do a series of 11 animal statues for permanent display on the Hillsdale Mall. With untiring effort and countless hours, Benny sawed, chiseled, inlaid, and polished a tremendous redwood burl into a magnificent owl statue as the key figure in this display. The plan was part of a basic concept by Hillsdale developer David Bohannon to integrate an artistic and cultural atmosphere in a commercial area, to bring fine art out where the most people can see and enjoy it. Developer Bohannon and California's Lieutenant Governor Powers were on hand with some 4,000 people, art critics, and the press for the unveiling ceremonies of Benny Bufano's magnificent statues. Benny is world famous for his animal sculpturing, especially renowned for his cats, and his love of animals and youngsters is obvious. The famous statues of St. Francis in Bufano's works are highlighted by this massive granite figure of the saint on horseback. Looking like some modern guided missile, here is the tremendous penguin and her babes. At the end of the long day of unveiling, the diminutive artist proudly scans his works and is shown here with his black granite bear and cubs, his red granite seal, the magnificent owl, The entire collection is heralded as an artistic addition to a beautiful shopping center. One of the highlights of the fall season was a full-scale flower festival. With the cooperation of the local garden editor and garden clubs from all over the county, a formal flower show was held, judged, prized, and received national recognition. The highlight of this week-long event was a style show featuring hats made of flowers, an exciting project of the club members. There was a special trophy in this class awarded to the winner by Miss California herself. The success of Hillsdale's Spring Auto Show prompted the car dealers and the merchants to request another show in the fall. Held in early November, Hillsdale's Auto Show was actually the first complete presentation of 1957 models in the entire country. The increased traffic built our total attendance over a 10-day period to some 300,000 people. Everyone seems to love new automobiles, young and old alike, and the show was a huge success for the shopping center as well as for the dealers. Christmas 1956 saw Hillsdale converted into a veritable wonderland of lights. The giant 50-foot tree of lights on the face of the Macy building was the focal point from the highway. Giant evergreens were colorfully decorated in various areas throughout the center. The entire center has the warm feeling of a real old-fashioned Christmas. The store windows and mall areas were completely decorated and flooded with over 5 miles of lights. Highlight of the children's attractions was the giant toy land on the mall. The biggest toys in the whole wide world, we called them. 15 of these huge animated toys were placed from one end of the mall to the other. Each one had a separate Christmas message for the children and would talk or sing at the touch of a button. This giant toy land, of course, was the feature of Hillsdale's Christmas advertising. And 30-foot replicas of the toy giraffe were used as cutouts on the spectacular billboards leading to the center. Yes, it really pays to advertise. Traffic-building promotions like merchandising must be sold to the public. To back up the foregoing Hillsdale promotions, all advertising media were used. These are a few of the feature newspaper advertisements from the various campaigns where large space and generous color proved very effective. Experience has proven that small announcement ads will not build great surges of traffic. The newspaper presentation of a worthwhile promotion must be in keeping with the size and scope of the promotion itself. The ultimate success of increased volume of business from traffic-building activities is dependent, of course, on the active merchandising to promotions by the merchants. They've got to get behind it to get the most out of it. The traffic-building promotions were tied together with a continuous institutional advertising campaign using all of the various media. Small, continual newspaper space has proven very worthwhile when run in conjunction with radio and TV, and selective showings of spectacular highway billboards. These promotions and special events provided a continuous flow of publicity pictures and stories in newspapers, magazines, radio, and television. Yes, shopping is fun at Hillsdale. And because it is, we believe that people have come to know us in more ways than one as the heart of the peninsula.
starring the entire Nelson family. Here's Ozzie. Here's Harriet. Here's David. And here's Rick. Here they are, America's favorite family, the Nelsons. Tonight's Adventures of Ozzie and Harriet is brought to you by your gas company, with pipeline companies and gas appliance and equipment manufacturers who help you and your family live modern for less with gas.
That's what we do at our house.
What's going on? Ozzie's planning a trip to the New York World's Fair.
You know, one of the most eye-opening things about the fair is the way it dramatizes what modern gas can do. Gas air conditions nearly 80% of the fair and heats over 90% of it. The General Motors Futurama, the Ford Pavilion, Bell Telephone, these are just a few of the spectacular pavilions heated and cooled by gas. We Nelsons chose gas heating and cooling for the same reasons. Gas is more dependable and more economical.
All the fine restaurants at the fair use gas. They like gas for its speed and control. So do I. And it's so clean.
Yeah, I can see us there now. What a dinner we'll have at Festival 65, the Gas Pavilion Restaurant.
Hey, wake up.
Fine thing, I was just about to taste that steak.
Well, relax, we're having steak broiled on our own gas range tonight.
Oh, good.
Why don't you and your family live modern for less with gas?
Hi. We're going to turn back the clock a few years this evening, 8 to be exact, and show you what happened to the Nelson household during Christmas week in 1956.
We thought we'd warn you just in case we all look a little younger. We hope you enjoy reminiscing with us. There certainly are lots of beautiful Christmas cards this year.
Yeah, they come in kind of early, aren't they?
Are you kidding? Christmas is less than a week away.
Is that possible? Boy, it really sneaks up on you.
Oh, here's a nice card from Dr. Williams and his family.
Oh, yeah. Boy, the kids are sure getting big. You'd think they'd write a little something on it, wouldn't you?
Well, no, not necessarily. It's a nice picture of the family.
Oh, yeah, I like these family photographs best of all, but I like people to write a little something on them, particularly when they're such good friends of ours. And here's what I mean. Listen to this. May this be your happiest Christmas, and may all that follow be even happier. Merry Christmas and Happy New Year. We hope we may always be privileged to include you among our nicest and best friends. Isn't that nice?
Oh, it certainly is. Who's it from?
The Acme Cleaners. Pardon me. Well, let's look at these games over here, Harriet. Harriet?
Attention, please. Calling Mrs. Muller. Calling Mrs. Muller. Little Irving is at the Lost and Found Department. Please come and get him. Thank you.
How much is this donkey party game, miss? Miss? Miss?
Hello, Mr. Nelson.
Well, hello there, Mrs. Brewster.
Attention, please. Mrs. Muller, please come and get little Irving. He's at the Lost and Found Department. Thank you.
I guess this must be the only quiet corner in the store. Quite a crowd, isn't it?
Isn't it, though? It seems that no matter how early I start my Christmas shopping, I always get caught in the last-minute rush.
Well, that's the way it goes.
Attention, please. Calling Irving Muller. That's Irving Muller. Your mother is waiting for you at the Lost and Found Department.
You know, every time I hear Silent Night, it reminds me of a wonderful Christmas Eve years ago when Harriet and I were first married. We'd finished trimming the tree, and we'd opened a few of our presents, and we're just sitting there in front of the fireplace. And all of a sudden, as if from out of nowhere, we heard voices singing Silent Night. It was a group of carolers, friends of ours, and they'd stopped in front of our house to sing for us. You know, one of my favorites, Deck the halls with boughs of holly. Fa la 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 la.
My goodness, isn't that a coincidence? We have the most wonderful arrangement of that.
Oh, well, how about that?
Why don't you and Mrs. Nelson join us? It wouldn't take much of your time.
Well, I'll speak to her and see how she feels about it.
Oh, she'd love it. Clara Randolph phoned her, and she said she'd be glad to if you were willing.
Now, hear this. Will little Ozzy Nelson please report to the Lost and Found Department? Oh, I beg your pardon. I'm sorry. Will Mr. Ozzy Nelson please report to the Lost and Found Department? Your wife is looking for you.
Hey, that looks real nice.
Thank you, dear.
Well, thanks, Bob. How come you didn't buy a Christmas tree when you were downtown?
Oh, it's a little too soon, Dave.
Your father wants to wait till Christmas Eve.
Well, no, it isn't a question of waiting until Christmas Eve. I just want to take things as they come along. I'm not going to get involved in a lot of complications this year.
Well, it seems to me you're involved already. You're going to sing Christmas carols.
Well, I got tricked into that, and you helped. But that's all I'm going to do.
When are we going to start putting up the lights outside the house, Bob?
We're not going to do that this year.
Who says so?
I said so. I'm the guy who gets stuck with all the work.
We'll help you.
Yeah, you guys always say that. But I'm the one who has to climb up on the roof and string the lights up.
Well, if you don't want to do anything so elaborate, why don't you just hang a few lights around the front door?
Oh, sure. I start putting them up around the front door, and somebody makes a few suggestions. All of a sudden, there's a ladder standing next to me, and the next thing I know, I'm up on the roof stringing the lights around the chimney.
Hi, Dave.
Oh, hi, Doctor. Come on in.
Thanks.
Pop, it's Dr. Williams.
Hi, Oz.
Hi, Doc.
Hello, Harriet.
Sit down.
No, I can only stay a minute. What do you think? I don't have enough to do, so they made me chairman of the Christmas Entertainment Committee at the Men's Club.
Oh, boy, that sounds like a lot of hard work.
Oh, I don't think so. It sounds like a lot of fun. You going to do the pageant again this year?
Well, we were going to, but Joe Randolph came up with the suggestion that we do Dickens' Christmas Carol. So they talked me into playing the nephew.
You see, Harriet, that's just what I was talking about. Here's a man, one of the busiest men in town, a doctor, and they impose on him and spoil his Christmas.
Are you kidding, Oz?
No, I'm not kidding.
Oh, I get it. Who told you?
Tell me what?
Oh, you sly dog, Oz. Okay, you can have the part. Here, I thought I was going to have to talk you into it, and you knew about it all along.
Now, wait a minute. If you think I'm going to play a part in your Christmas play, you got another thing coming.
That's perfect, Oz. That's old Scrooge himself. Christmas. Bah,
humbug. Well, here you'd be wonderful.
Well, sure you would. We'll count on you, Oz.
Now, wait a minute. In the first place, how am I going to learn that big, long part?
Well, that'll be easy. We're going to do a short version. I'll send you the script.
Won't you stay for some coffee, Doc?
Oh, no thanks, Harriet. I got to get home. I promised Cheryl I'd start putting up the lights around the house.
Oh, we aren't going to put up any lights this year.
You're not?
Oh, well, yes, we are. We're just not going to make such a big deal of it, that's all.
Oh, that's a shame. Well, we'll count on you playing Scrooge, Oz. Christmas. Bah, humbug. Hi, Oz.
Well, hello there, Joe. Hey, you're just in time. How'd you like to help me hang these lights up in front of the house?
Oh, no, thanks, Oz. I've got plenty to do as it is. I'll tell you why I dropped by. You know, the lodge is putting on the annual Christmas Eve party at the orphanage again.
Oh, that's a nice idea.
Oh, it's a great idea. But Tubby McIntyre always played Santa Claus for us, and he moved out of town about a month ago, and we just found out that he always used his own Santa Claus outfit.
Oh, I have a Santa Claus outfit right up in the attic.
Oh, gee, that's great, Oz. If you're there at 7, it'll be just about right, and we'll have the bag of toys waiting for you.
Look, you're welcome to borrow the outfit, but I can't be Santa Claus.
Oh, sure you can, Oz, with that wonderful, hearty laugh of yours. Oh. And you can put a pillow in front there. Oh. I don't know, maybe you won't need a pillow.
Oh, the sweater I'm wearing here. I'll need a pillow.
Oh, suit yourself, but Oz, thanks so much. You've taken a load off my mind.
Well, no.
Christmas Eve, 7 o'clock at the orphanage.
Well, just a minute, Harriet. Joe?
Ozzy?
Harriet, what do you want?
I thought you were going to put up the Christmas lights on the front of the house.
Well, I will. I'm just getting them untangled here.
Oh, well, here, these are for you. Doc sent over your part for the Christmas play, and Mrs. Brewster dropped off the music. She said, would you please learn the bass part?
Thanks. Deck the halls with boughs of holly, fa la 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 la. Christmas. Bah. Humbug.
What'd you say, dear?
Christmas. Bah! Humbug!
Well, that's a fine Christmas spirit.
That's my part in a play. Christmas. Bah! Humbug! Does that sound convincing?
Yes, I hate you.
Thank you, dear.
You know, I just don't know how you're going to do all the stuff you promised to do.
Well, why not?
Well, everything happens on Christmas Eve, which is tomorrow night, in case you've forgotten.
Well, I know. I'll just have to work out a tight schedule, that's all.
What about the lights?
Well, I'll take care of those. Don't worry.
Why don't you put them up now?
Well, Harriet, I've got this whole big part to learn.
You can study while you're up on the ladder.
Are you kidding? Look, this is Dickens' Christmas Carol. It's not Romeo and Juliet.
Oh, and what about the Christmas tree? Shall I get that? I have to go downtown anyway and pick up some tree ornaments.
No, Harriet, I told you, I'll take care of the Christmas tree. One thing at a time.
Okay.
Christmas. Bah! Humbug!
Deck the halls with boughs of holly. Fa la 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 la.
Bob Cratchit? So you'll want a day off tomorrow, I suppose. Convenient? Of course it's not convenient. Once a year? A poor excuse for picking a man's pocket every 25th of December.
Ebenezer Scrooge. Ebenezer Scrooge.
How now? Who are you?
Ask me who I was.
Who was you? Who were you?
In life, I was your partner, Jacob Marley.
No, no, no. See, you're Marley's ghost. I'm Scrooge. See, in life, I was your partner, Jacob Marley. See, that's your name. You're Jacob Marley, or Marley's ghost. Try it again.
In life, I was your partner, Jacob Marley.
You're Marley's ghost.
That I am. That I am.
Would you say that there?
No, but I just thought it fit pretty good.
Don't ad-lib. Just give me the lines the way they're written there, because that's the way I'm supposed to learn them.
I can't believe it.
It must be my indigestion. For all I know, you may be an undigested bit of beef, a blot of mustard, a crumb of cheese, a fragment of an underdone potato. Did I leave anything out there?
How about a pistachio ice cream soda with an onion in it?
Spoil the mood, David.
Hey, what are you doing anyway? That's my sheet.
I'm helping Pop rehearse.
Rick?
Trouble with you is you got no artistic appreciation.
Rick?
Rick, give me the next line.
I thought you were putting up the light.
Oh, well, I was on my way up to the roof, and I dropped into the boys' room to rehearse my part.
Well, there's a telephone call for you. Oh, here he comes now, Joe. It's Joe Randolph.
Oh.
Why didn't you come down the stairs?
Well, I went up the ladder. Hello, Joe.
Oh, hi, Oz. I was just wondering, did you find your Santa Claus outfit?
Oh, well, not yet, but I know where it is. It's right up in the attic. Don't worry about it.
Okay, just checking on everybody.
I'll see you tomorrow night around 7 o'clock. So long, Joe.
Where are you going?
Up to get my Santa Claus outfit before I forget it.
What about the lights?
Oh, well, I'll crawl out the attic window and fix them on the way down.
Mr. Nelson.
Oh, hello, Miss Brewster.
I stopped by to tell you we'll pick you up tomorrow night at 9 o'clock.
Well, gee, I hope I'm finished at the men's club on time.
I have some more music here for you.
Oh, I'll be right down.
Ebenezer Scrooge.
No, not now, Rick.
Your part is all marked in red. Oh, you are a bass, aren't you?
Well, I don't think so.
Oh, dear, I'd appreciate it very much if you would be a bass. We're so shy on basses this year.
Oh, well, all right. I've already learned the one bass part, you know.
Oh, that's just fine. Well, see you tomorrow night. Bye.
Okay.
Deck the halls with boughs of holly. Fa la 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 la. I
I'm dreaming of a white Christmas. Deck the halls with boughs of holly. La-la-la-la-la-la.
Ebenezer Scrooge.
Oh, there you are. You're neither Marley nor his ghost.
I'm Marley's brother.
How now, Marley's brother?
We dine.
But I gotta fix the lights.
Now make haste, Scrooge. The festive board is set with a blot of mustard and all that other jazz.
I won.
Who really won when the well-known Stannis fluoride brand was clinically compared with Colgate's famous Gardol formula? You and your family won, because Colgate, with a taste your family likes best, is unsurpassed in reducing new cavities. Colgate tastes best, helps stop bad breath, stops mouth odor for most people instantly, and Colgate is a leader in reducing new cavities. It's just got to be the best toothpaste for your family.
Wherever you go, whatever you do,
your hair behaves so beautifully with Luster Cream Shampoo. So rich, you only need to lather once. Then your hair is shining clean with more body, more life.
Wherever you go, whatever you do, your hair behaves beautifully with Luster Cream Shampoo.
Liquid or concentrate.
Deck the halls with boughs of holly. Fa la 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 la.
Ebenezer Scrooge.
How now? Who are you?
I'm Santa Claus' wife, and I freshed your suit. Here, I'll put it on.
Oh, thank you. I fixed this beard for you, Pop. The wire was bent.
Oh, thank you, Dave.
I get it. Say, how about the lights on the house tonight? Your last chance.
Well, I'll put them up as soon as I get back from buying the tree.
Hello? Oh, hi, Jill. He's got to be over at the men's club by 8 o'clock. Oh, okay, I'll tell him.
What was that all about?
Well, that was Joe Randolph, and they've changed the plans. They've got so many children, they're going to give two parties at the orphanage. One at 6 and one at 7:30.
I can't be there by 6.
Oh, sure you can. Oh, will you get that?
What time are the Christmas carols, Pop?
Oh, they're at 9 o'clock. Oh, hi, Doc.
Hi, Oz. Say, I'm in kind of a hurry. I got an emergency call from the hospital. Would you do me a favor and run down and pick up the costumes? They're being altered. Here's the address.
Well, Doc.
Oh, be sure and try the pants on. Remember, they were kind of tight across the seat.
What does the man take a job for if he's not going
to
do it?
You want me to drive you over there, Pop?
Oh, yeah, maybe that's a good idea, Dave. This is way over the other side of town.
Well, dinner's practically ready.
Well, hey, I don't have time to eat dinner.
I'll go start the car.
Oh, thanks, Dave. Boy, here we go again. It's a fine way to spend Christmas Eve.
Oh, don't forget your beard.
Thanks. But where'll I meet you?
Well, I've got a couple of things to do, so I'll meet you back here, okay?
Okay, bye. Coming.
Good luck.
You think these pants are awfully tight?
Oh, no. That's the way they wore them in those days.
You better try the coat on, Pop. It's getting awful late. Gee, looks great, Pop.
Thank you. Is this all right, Mr. Nelson?
Oh, yeah, I'll be fine. Thank you.
Merry Christmas, boys and girls! Merry Christmas! Lots of toys for little girls and boys!
It was swell.
I'm glad to do it, Joe.
I better get back to the kids.
Okay, I'll see you.
I don't know how to thank you, Mr. Nelson. The children had a wonderful time.
Well, it was my pleasure. Okay, Dave, I'll be right there. Well, I'll be seeing you.
Oh, Mr. Nelson, you dropped your beard.
Oh, thank you.
See, what did I tell you?
Merry Christmas, Uncle.
Merry Christmas.
Bah, humbug. Uncle, don't be cross.
What else can I be when I live in a world of fools such as this? Merry Christmas. Bah, humbug! Merry Christmas. Bah, humbug! You keep Christmas in your way. Your way. I'll keep Christmas in mine.
Uncle, I have come to see you in homage to Christmas, and I'll keep my Christmas spirit to the last. Well, nonetheless, Merry Christmas, Uncle.
Merry Christmas. Bah! Humbug! I'm sure glad you weren't there. It was so darn embarrassing.
Oh, well, I wouldn't worry about it, dear. They probably thought it was part of the play.
Yeah, I thought it was swell, Pop. Everybody laughed.
Well, that's for sure. Gee, I didn't get a Christmas tree.
Oh, Ricky's getting one.
Oh, good.
Give me your coat.
Rick? I'm sorry, Pop. This is the best I could do. They're all sold out.
Well, it wasn't your fault, son. I should have bought a tree weeks ago. Hey.
What's the matter?
Oh, I banged my knee. Trying to climb in and out of the car so darn fast.
Oh, it's a shame, dear.
Oh, I meant to tell you, Pop. I got a parking ticket outside the men's club. Gee, I didn't know it was a red zone.
Boy, that does it. That's the end.
Here, let me see it, Dave.
I spend all week knocking myself out, and what do I wind up with? A broken leg, a parking ticket, a scraggly, scrawny-looking Christmas tree.
Hey, wait a minute. This isn't a parking ticket. It says you are hereby sentenced to a Merry Christmas and a Happy New Year. Don't forget the policeman's ball January 15th. It sure is.
Well, come on, gang. Let's join the carolers.
Yeah, come on. Let's go, boys.
Hey, it's snowing outside.
Yeah, how about that?
Oh, how wonderful.
Harriet, where's my top coat?
It's in the den, dear.
In the den?
Surprise! Surprise!
Beautiful. Gee, thanks, fellas.
Jingle bells.
It's going to be the most wonderful Christmas we've ever had.
I think so, too.
Oh, what fun it is to ride in a one-horse open sleigh. Oh, jingle bells, jingle bells, jingle all the way. Oh, what fun it is to ride in a one-horse.
Have lights up in front of the house.
Yeah, what happened?
I know it, Doc. I kept promising Harriet I'd put him up, but I just never got around to it. It's all my fault.
Okay, Ricky, hit the switch.
Oh.
Hey!
We'll be back.
Well, Ricky and I did. We didn't want you and David to have all the fun.
Well, how about that? A man doesn't know what goes on in his own house.
Well, come on, let's get going.
How about deck the halls? I've been practicing the bass part all week.
Okay, here we go. Deck.
Deck the halls with boughs of holly. Fa-la-la-la-la-la-la-la. Tis the season to be jolly. Fa-la-la-la-la-la-la-la-la. Fa-la-la-la-la-la-la-la-la. Troll the ancient youth I carol. Fa-la-la-la-la-la-la-la-la. Deck the halls with boughs of holly.
Well, that's what happened at the Nelson household during Christmas week in 1956, 8 years ago. And now here we are, it's practically Christmas 1964. We're all a few years older, and our family is a little bigger, we're happy to say.
In fact, there are 8 of us now instead of 4. So if you'll stay with us for just a moment, we'll be right back while Rick sings the Christmas song, and we'll meet the entire family.
That's Dave and June and their little boy Danny, and Rick and Chris and their little daughter Tracy. We'll be back in just 60 seconds.
25 hamburgers, 20 lamb chops, or 2 whole chickens. That's the amazing capacity of the most advanced broiler offered on ranges today. And you'll find it on the new Caloric 75. And it's only available in gas. I'm Jinx Falkenberg. Here's how Caloric's patented ultra-ray gas broiler works. Invisible infrared rays produced by gas cook more evenly and 30% faster than other type broilers. You have to taste meat broiled this way to believe how juicy and tender it is. And here's the inside story, why this new Caloric 75 is so easy to clean. And it stays cleaner because gas consumes smoke and spatter. There are 2 huge ovens, both with keep warm controls. Let your gas company or dealer show you why this Caloric 75 gas range can help you live modern for less with gas.
Chestnuts roasting on an open fire. Jack Frost nipping at your nose. Yuletide carols being sung by a choir. And folks dressed up like Eskimos. Everybody knows a turkey and some mistletoe help to make the season bright. Tiny tots with their eyes all aglow will find it hard to sleep tonight. They know that Santa's on his way. He's loaded lots of toys and goodies on his sleigh. And every mother's child is gonna spy to see if reindeer really know how to fly. And so I'm offering this simple phrase to kids from 1 to 92. Although it's been said many times, many ways, Merry Christmas to you.
Now, on behalf of all us Nelsons, Dave, June, and Danny, Rick, and Chris, and Tracy, and Harriet, and myself, we want to wish you a very Merry Christmas.
Merry Christmas.
Merry Christmas. Merry Christmas.
Tonight's Adventures of Ozzie and Harriet was brought to you by your gas company,
which helps you live modern for less with gas.
That's what we Nelsons do.
Could you give me a box for this? Because if I wrap it as it is, Professor Plum will know right away. As soon as I hand it to him, what it is, he's going to... We hope you have enjoyed tonight's Christmas Weird-tacular. Please feel free to email us your comments about it. Also be sure to check out weirdorama.com for website-exclusive episodes, our blog, our Twitter feed, and our Facebook fan page, and everything else I'm probably forgetting. So, for all of us here at Weird-O-Rama, this is Victor Von Psychotron telling all of you to stay weird. And have a Merry Christmas.